Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah.
It's
an honor and privilege to be in this beautiful company, and it's a maidan of mahabba. It's an arena of love, and so the hearts are warmed, and it's really we ask Allah to include us in the prophetic description of such gatherings of His remembrance, that the sakina descends, tranquility, and the angelic presence is there, the angels are present, and the mercy of Allah Ta'ala envelops us, and that Allah Ta'ala Himself remembers us in His, the Malil A'la. Our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was a prophet of hope and optimism. And it's difficult to read the seerah, the blessed life of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, except that one is filled with a sense of awe at the hope of our blessed Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in his Lord. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that I can just hold it maybe. Yeah. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the hadith that's related in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, لا طيرت ولكن يعجبني الفأل وقال والفأل الكلمة الحسنة الطيبة. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that there's no such thing as superstition or bad omens, bad luck, these kind of things. They have no reality. But I love optimism. And optimism is a goodly, pure word or pure statements, good speech. And the scholars clarify that if one is trying to fulfill a need, and in that process, Allah Ta'ala takes them such that they encounter a person of righteousness, such that, you know, a place or a time in which it occurs is there's something of barakah, then it is from the sunnah to actually intuit from that positivity that Allah Ta'ala is helping that person, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deliver them from whatever, you know, difficulty that they're in. And another principle that is from the prophetic way is raja, which is hope in the divine. And Imam Qushayri, he says that raja is qurb al-qalb min mulatafat al-rab. It is for the heart to be near to the subtle grace of the divine. In other words, to intuit the omnipresent, subtle mercy and grace of Allah Ta'ala that imbues this cosmos. وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. And my mercy encompasses every single thing. And so no matter how difficult a situation might appear to be, it is not divorced from the divine mercy. The divine mercy is ever present. If we are open, if we have that hope, that optimism, to intuit it, to recognize it, to embrace it. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his optimism was grounded in his perception of divine beauty. And he was the most perceptive of divine beauty. He was the most cognizant, the one who recognized the most the beauty of Allah Ta'ala, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And thus, whatever challenges and difficulties he faced, as we read in the seerah, he was never, you know, unsettled, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And inasmuch as he was the most perceptive of the divine beauty, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was also the most reflective of the divine beauty, such that the people who were blessed to be around him as believers, the companions, Allah be pleased with them, they could intuit that sublime reflection of Allah's nur in his blessed person. So his luminosity, his radiance, there are over 40 companions and contemporaries of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that described him as luminous. And, you know, The Al-Bara ibn Azib, one of the companions, radiallahu anhu, as is related in Bukhari and Muslim, that he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ شَيْئًا قَتْ أَحْسَن مِّن رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He said, I never saw anything more beautiful than God's messenger. And they would even perceive it from his blessed speech, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Ibn Abbas relates a hadith that's in the Shama'il, that the Shama'il of Imam Tirmidhi, radiallahu anhuma, that كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أفلج الثنيتين, that the Blessed Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had a small gap between his middle teeth. And this is something the Arabs considered very handsome, signifying beauty. And he said that إِذَا تَكَلَّمَ, when the Prophet would speak, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, رُوِيَ كَالنُّورِ يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْنِ ثَنَايَاهُ, that it would be seen as light emanating from between those blessed teeth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu, in the hadith of Tirmidhi also relates, radiallahu anhu, that he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ شَيْئًا أَحْسَن مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, I never saw anything more beautiful than God's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, كَأَنَّ الشَّمْسْ تَجْرِي فِي وَجْهِهِ, it was as if the sun itself were flowing in his blessed face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the great companion Jabir ibn Samura, also in the Shama'il of Imam Tirmidhi, radiallahu anhu, that he said, in Sahih Muslim, he said, كَانَ وَجْهُهُ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam مِثْلَ الشَّمْسِ وَالْقَمَرِ, he said that the blessed face of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was like the sun and the moon. Was like the sun and the moon. And the same companion, Jabir ibn Samura, radiallahu anhu, in the Shama'il of Imam Tirmidhi, he says that on one night, he says, Ra'aytu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi laylatin idhiyan. He says, one night I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it was a night that was moonlit from the beginning to the end of the night. Idhiyan means, Imam Jasus says, the moon was bright from the beginning to the end of the night. And he says, wa alayhi hullatun hamra, and he was wearing a red garment. And he says, fa ja'altu anduru ilayhi wa ila al-qamar, and so I started looking at him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and at the full, bright, luminous moon, back and forth, back and forth. Falahu indi ahsanu min al-qamar. And he says, radiallahu anhu, the lam is for an oath. It's like saying, by Allah, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in my estimate, in my opinion, in my view, was far more beautiful than the moon. And the ulama clarified that when he says indi, it's not as if it was only his opinion, but he's taking sharaf, tasharruf. It's like this is in me. It, with me is that he is better than the moon, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some of the ulama say that these comparisons to the sun and the moon, that the tamthil is actually reversed. It's an inverted comparison. So the wording is that he is like the sun, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is like the moon. But in reality, the ulama say, some of the scholars say that the sun and the moon were like him. Right? Because which one is higher in luminosity? Which one is higher in radiance? And this is why there's a poet, Imam Salihi, in his Subul al-Huda wa Rashad, the 12-volume book of Seerah, beautiful book of Seerah, he cites one of the great poets. He says that, وَلِمَ لَا يُضِيءُ بِكَ الْوُجُودُ وَلَيْلُهُ وَفِيهِ سَبَاحٌ مِنْ جَمَالِكَ مُسْفِرُ وَبِشَمْسِ حُسْنِكَ كُلُّ يَوْمٍ مُشْرِقٌ وَبِبَدْرِ وَجْهِكَ كُلُّ لَيْلٍ مُقْمِرُ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That he says, why would it not be the case that the entire cosmos, its day and its night, is lit up through you? Because every morning, it's from your jamal, it's from your beauty that the day gives its light. And he says, and so it's from the sun, the shams, the sun of your beauty, that every day gives light, and it's from the full moon of your blessed face that the night has a moonlit night, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he is the asl, and every beauty in the world is a reflection of his asl, is of his light, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Sheikh Abdul Hakim Murad, I think he has a contention that I don't fully understand, but it hovers around this meaning, that every perception of beauty, every perception of beauty is a prayer upon the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so when we witness beauty in the world, we are capturing something, we are recognizing something of that supreme asl, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so how could he and his companions not be anything but hopeful, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And so then we reflect on the seerah and we see that with all that luminosity, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with all that radiance, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that time and time again, whatever negativity, whatever darkness that he encountered in the world, it did not it did not affect him. It did not move him away from his connection with his Lord, from his trust in his Lord, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَن يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so, for example, that when the early in the Meccan period, when the Quraysh in their vehemence and their vileness, they started writing poetry against him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they were so much calumny, so much slander against him, that they even changed his blessed name. So his blessed name is Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which linguistically means the one that is praised so much, the one that is receiving so much praise. So they switched it and they made it, you know, astaghfirullah al-azim, mudhammam, which is the opposite meaning. And so then they were spreading this horrible poetry and using that false name instead of his true name. And so he's sitting with the companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as is related in authentic hadith, the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, that he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفَلَا تَعْجَبُونَ كَيْفَ يَسْرِفُ اللَّهُ عَنِّي شَتْمَ قُرَيْشٍ وَلَعْنَهُمْ يَشْتَمُونَ مُذَمَّمًا وَيَلْعَنُونَ مُذَمَّمًا وَأَنَا مُحَمَّدٌ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, isn't it amazing? It's an optimism. Look at the positivity, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, isn't it amazing how Allah Ta'ala diverted the slander and the you know the calumny of Quraysh away from me? Because they're directing all of that stuff against someone named Muthammam. But that's not my name. My name is Muhammad. Subhanallah. Like he see all that radiance, so he could only see the nur. He could only see the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Later in the seerah, in the Meccan period for 10 years, every Hajj season, he would go and make da'wah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inviting all of these big tribes, up to a dozen or more tribes and clans of tribes that were visiting from around Arabia, and he was inviting them to Islam, preaching the oneness of Allah Ta'ala, and then asking them if they would support him because of all the persecution in Mecca, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in the Tabaqat of Ibn Sa'd, he relates that Abu Lahab would be following him wherever he goes, and then he would be slandering him right afterwards. So his attempt to make da'wah would be affected. So people would say, well, if that's his own family, so they would get hesitancy. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the dua, he says, Allahumma, lo shi'ta lam yakunu hakada. Subhanallah. He is always with his Lord, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he says, oh Allah, if you willed, they would not have been like this. Referring to Abu Lahab and whoever reacted in a negative way. Oh Allah, had you willed, they would not have been like this. Because Allah Ta'ala is in His dominion, is the cosmos, which includes the heart of every human being. If there's any person that is causing us problems, we have to recall this sunnah of recognizing that Allah Ta'ala is in full control of that person's heart. And this is why one of the inheritors of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr al-Warraq, a great imam from Balkh, he died 240 after Hijrah, rahimahullah ta'ala. A man once came to him and said, I'm afraid of so-and-so. And he said, La takhaf minhu, fa inna kulla qalbi man takhafuhu biyadi man tarjuhu. That he says that do not be afraid of him, because the heart of every individual that you fear is in the grasp of the one that you hope in. The heart of every individual that you fear is in the control of the one that you have hope in. And another inheritor of our Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when we learn from the inheritors, we're learning from the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because as Imam Busiri, one of my blessed teachers, he passed away last year, Sheikh Ahmad Jamal, rahimahullah ta'ala, he taught us when we asked him about different imams, taking from different imams, he said, وَكُلُّهُمْ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ مُلْتَمِسٌ غَرْفًا مِنَ الْبَحْرِ أَوْ رَشْفًا مِنَ الدِّيَمِ. So the line from the Burda, that all of them are taking a scoop from the ocean of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or a sip from his continuous rain. So the great imams and the ulama and the awliya of our tradition, they are reflecting that light, the light of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his hidayah. And so another inheritor of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Qasim al-Khassasi, he's a great Moroccan, one of the Salihin of Morocco. He died 1083 after Hijrah, and he's one of the six Shadhilis that are buried together in Fez, rahimahullah ta'ala. He once taught his student. His student came to him with a similar problem. He said, لا تشتغل قط بمن يؤذيك واشتغل بالله. He says, never become overly preoccupied with someone who is harming you, someone who is causing you problems. Rather, be preoccupied with Allah. And the sunnah is we take the means, we don't become, you know, a punching bag for people trying to harm us, so we take the means of protection. But what occupies our mind? What occupies our heart? So the great Imam is saying, do not let your heart and mind be overwhelmed, preoccupied with the one who is showing animosity to you. Rather, be preoccupied with Allah Ta'ala. يَرُدُّهُ عَنْكَ. And if you are preoccupied with Allah, Allah will divert that person away from you. فَإِنَّهُ هُوَ الَّذِي حَرَّكَهُ عَلَيْكَ لِيَخْتَبِرَ دَعْوَاكَ فِي الصِّدْقِ. Because Allah is the one originally who stirred that person, incited that person against you to test your claim to be sincere, to test your claim of sincerity. And so we have to always return to Allah Ta'ala, whatever challenge. This is a beautiful sunnah and one of the essential principles of optimism of our blessed Prophet, a Prophet of Hope, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so that the Prophet, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we know the stories of the Hijrah, and that when Abu Bakr, radhiyallahu anhu, they were in the cave in Jabal Thawr, and Abu Bakr says that, Ya Rasulullah, if they just look down, they were above them, if they just look down, they're going to see us. And what does the Prophet say, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? مَا ذَنُّكَ يَا أَبَا بَكْرِ بِثْنَيْنَ اللَّهُ ثَالِثُهُمَا. He is with Allah Ta'ala. His preoccupation, what is occupying his blessed heart, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in a time where anyone else would be, you know, completely filled and replete with anxiety, he says, oh Abu Bakr, what do you think of two? Allah is their third. And as Imam Tahir, Allah preserve him, cited earlier from Surah At-Tawbah, إِذْ هُمَا فِي الْغَارِ إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. This is the essential foundation of optimism and prophetic hope. And the other hadith of Du'thur later in the Medinan period, when he went out once on an expedition, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, against one of the clans of Ghatafan, and he rested under a tree and hung his blessed sword, and the head of that clan, Du'thur, in some narrations Du'thur, in others Ghawrath, there's discrepancy what his name was, Ibn al-Harith al-Muharibi, he came and he grabbed the sword and he pointed it at the Blessed Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the Prophet opens his eyes, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the man says, Man yamna'uka minni, who's gonna protect you from me now? And in the hadith, authentic hadith, in Riyadh al-Salihin, and Bukhari Muslim, he says, Allah, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And in one narration, ثلاث مرات, Allah, Allah, Allah. Ibn Alan, the commentator of Riyadh al-Salihin, says he said it three times, taladudhan bidhikrihi, out of joy in enjoying the remembrance of Allah, like Subhanallah. We don't really know our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We just have like Subhanallah. May Allah Taala give us more knowledge of Allah and His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, with His lutf, Subhanahu Wa Taala. So. It's and then the sword drops and the Prophet raises it and says, Man yamna'uka minni, who's gonna stop you from me? And the man says, Kun khayra akhid, you know, be graceful and you know, spare me. And so the Prophet, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the man agrees to stop fighting the Muslims, and the Prophet says, you can go. The man goes back, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he just attempted to take his blessed life. The man goes back, he says to his people, Jittukum min indi khayrin nas. I have come to you from the best of people, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is this luminosity. Look at his optimism, because he is so grounded in the remembrance of Allah Ta'ala. And it's the remembrance of Allah Ta'ala that he emphasized so much to the companions. So he said once on the way back, they passed a mountain, this hadith in Sahih Muslim, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he said, Sabaqal Mufarridun. You know, those people who isolate themselves regularly for devotion. Those people who isolate themselves regularly for devotion and the remembrance of God, they have outstripped everyone. And the companions, this term, Mufarridun, they weren't sure what it meant. They said, وَمَا الْمُفَرِّدُونَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. What is the description of these people, O God's Messenger, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? He said, أَذَّاكِرُونَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ. Men and women that make plentiful and sincere remembrance to Allah Ta'ala, of Allah Ta'ala. And in the riwayah of Imam Tirmidhi, he said, الْمُسْتَهْدَرُونَ فِي ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. يَدَعُ الذِّكْرُ عَنْهُمْ أَثْقَالُهُمْ فَيَأْتُونَ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ خِفَافًا. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He said, the people that are immersed in the remembrance of Allah. such that the remembrance of Allah lifts for them their burdens. Right? It lifts for them their burdens, the burdens of sin that weigh us down, such that they arrive on the Day of Judgment light and easy. Such that they arrive on the Day of Judgment light and easy. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith of Ibn Majah, that hadith Qudsi, he cited his Lord, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah Ta'ala, that أَنَا مَعَ عَبْدِي إِذَا هُوَ ذَكَرَنِي وَتَحَرَّكَتْ بِي شَفَتَي. That Allah Ta'ala says, I'm with my servant when he makes remembrance of me and his two lips move with my dhikr. I'm with my servant when he makes remembrance of me and his two lips move with my remembrance. And in the version of Sahih al-Bukhari, it's connected to a good opinion of Allah. أَنَا عِنْدَ ذَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي. That Allah Ta'ala says, according to the hadith, أَنَا عِنْدَ ذَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي وَأَنَا مَعَهُ إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي. I am in the opinion of my servant of me, and I am with him when he makes remembrance of me. So the good opinion of Allah, which is the foundation of optimism, is conjoined to the remembrance of Allah. So we have to be people who regularly invoke the divine in beyond the obligations. The obligations are the foundation, and then beyond that, to cultivate a consistent habits of remembrance of God. This opens the heart, illuminates the heart, such that the prophetic optimism can transpire. And so, husna dhan billah, having a good opinion of Allah Ta'ala. Malik ibn Dinar, one of the tabi'een, he was seen in a dream after his death. And they said, the man in the dream, he said, asked him, what did Allah do with you? He says, قَدِمْتُ عَلَى رَبِّي بِذُنُوبْ كَثِيرًا. He says, I arrived to my Lord with many, many sins. مَحَاهَا عَنِّي حُسْنَ ذَنِّي بِهِ تَعَالَى. But they were all erased because of my good opinion of him. They were all erased because of my good opinion of him. And the Prophet taught us, صلى الله عليه وسلم, in Sahih Muslim, لَا يَمُوتَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ إِلَّا وَهُوَ يُحَسِّنَ الظَّنِّ بِاللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Let none of you die. We all know people that passed away this last year. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, let none of you die except having the best, having a beautiful opinion of Allah Ta'ala. Let none of you die except, this is a command, let none of you die except while having a beautiful opinion of Allah Ta'ala. And in some riwayat, he said this 3 days before he passed away, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Shaykh al-Akbar, he says that this is proof that we should have a good opinion in each of our breaths. We should have a beautiful opinion of Allah with every breath that we take, because we don't know which breath will be our last. And so it's impossible to fulfill this hadith, to be guaranteed to fulfill this hadith, unless one is always having a good opinion of Allah Ta'ala. So we ask Allah Ta'ala to make us prophetic.
Ameen.
In our optimism, in our Lord, in our hope of Allah, in Allah Ta'ala. We ask Allah Ta'ala to illuminate our hearts with His remembrance and with love of Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that translates to beautiful service of His creation. We ask Allah Ta'ala to make His people who adorn our hearts with a beautiful opinion of Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that we are those that our Prophet is pleased with. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ النَّبِيُّ الْأُمِّيِّ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.